Thanks very much, Jeff, and thank you for the organisers to invite me to speak about what I think is a very important topic. My view of irritable bowel syndrome is that the management strategies are changing completely. It's becoming a multidisciplinary management scene. We know that if we make a confident diagnosis, we use the placebo. It's probably our major tool. But many patients who have more severe symptoms will require specific therapies. And these specific therapies, I would suggest, involve three components. One is dietary therapy, the second psychological therapy, and the third adjunct therapies. With dietary therapies, we have evidence for low FODMAP diet, but there are other approaches. There are multiple approaches in psychological therapies. And our adjunct therapies, I think, are now emerging, and I'll talk about some of those. However, the majority of my talk will address dietary and psychological therapies. So why should we even bother? Well, there are well-defined strategies. Management of lifestyle and psychological issues for a chronic, non-fatal illness with drugs is not, to me, an attractive option, and lifestyle is much better. There's evidence that efficacy for all the symptoms occur in 3 or 4 patients with these techniques. But most importantly, we have to apply these with intelligence and knowledge of what they are, and have to be aware of the risks. They're not just something simple. Now, if we take a really simplistic view, then dietary strategies are really targeting the gut in the gut-brain type sequence, pathogenic target. That the idea being that food may be a major driver in the gut, and that the brain is a secondary partner, and if we remove the cause, if food is the cause, or reduce the driving stimuli, then it will help. For psychological strategies, it's more about the brain to gut issues, where autonomic dysfunction will contribute to the visceral hypersensitivity motility dysfunction, and it's all enhanced by psychological distress, and that if we reduce arousal of the autonomic nervous system and decrease the stress response, we will have some benefits. So what about dietary strategies? Well, there are many reasons to use diet. First of all, that most patients will recognise that ingestion of food induces their symptoms. And there's a huge community and patient interest in treating and using diet to treat illness. And in fact, it is the primary behavioural factor that patients use. So we have to engage with this. There are multiple mechanisms by which food can induce symptoms, and we now have quality evidence for efficacy of specific diets. The most common dietary strategies for IBS are gluten-free diet and low FODMAP diet. Gluten-free diet will be addressed by our next speaker. However, I will just say, well, why is gluten-free diet so commonly used? And in Australia, it is just like in the United States. Well, there's expert consensus endorsement of the gluten-free diet, particularly in the so-called non-celiac gluten sensitivity. We have a celebrity endorsement, including scaremongering from many points of view, and I would note that Novak Djokovic, he was number 2 in the world until he went on a gluten-free diet, then he became number 1 and felt that was cause and effect. And that is very compelling. Gluten-free diet does reduce symptoms in IBS, there's no doubt. But the issue is, are the benefits due to removal of gluten? Or are we just, is it not the most appropriate therapy? Well, I'd like to move on then, and we'll come back to that. But the FODMAP concept was that we consider all indigestible and slowly absorbed short-chain carbohydrates collectively. We knew that fructose, lactose, fructans, galacto-oligosaccharides and polyols like sorbitol all induce symptoms which are like IBS-type symptoms. That's been well documented. And they do it by distending the small bowel with for osmotic action. And here's some nice MRI studies from Robin Spiller's group showing how much you get increase small intestinal water when you ingest free fructose. They also are like a McDonald's to microbiota, and they produce rapidly ferment them and produce lots of gas. And here you can show with a high and low FODMAP diet what happens to the hydrogen production. And so the idea is that if you can, they have additive effects, contribute to symptoms in people who have visceral hypersensitivity. These effects will occur in all of us, but if you have hypersensitivity, then the FODMAPs will cause problems. The real problem with FODMAPs is that they're found in multiple foods, multiple vegetables and fruits. And here is showing some of them. The principle of the diet is that we have a first phase, is a really an exclusion phase, where we avoid all foods that are high in FODMAPs and replace them with foods that are low in FODMAPs in each group. So it's not a completely exclusion diet, it's a replacement diet. We usually use this for 4 to 6 weeks, just a convenient time, because response usually occurs within the first week. If there's no benefit, we recommend to stop the therapy, and of course that's what patients don't always do. If there's efficacy, we then go into the second phase, which is a step down, because most people do not need the strict restriction, and they just they learn what they need to restrict according to tolerance. Most importantly, this diet has been a dietitian-delivered diet and not something which is delivered with a piece of paper. There's evidence of short-term benefits of the low FODMAP diet, and the quality of the studies is always reduced with diet because of difficulties with the comparator and with the actual other problems with it. The first, I think, most important study was the one that proved the concept, which was a feeding study that we performed where we gave people a typical Australian FODMAP diet and a low FODMAP diet and showed a considerable difference in only 30 patients. There have been followed studies from UK, Canada and the USA with different comparators, high FODMAP diet, habitual diet and the NICE diet, which is a more lifestyle type diet from UK, and showed a significant benefits of the low FODMAP diet over these comparators. And what has just been released in Gastroenterology is a study from King's College London, where there was a true sham diet delivered by a dietitian, a true placebo diet, which where the low FODMAP diet showed efficacy. The real issue is whether there is evidence in the long term, and it's really difficult to do studies in this area. And the question is, after an elimination phase and reintroduction, which where we were calling an adapted or modified FODMAP diet, do we get benefits? Well, there are only uncontrolled prospective studies. There are three of them now reported where people who have a response at 6 weeks maintain in the vast majority over 6 to 12 months. And this is with reintroduction of many FODMAPs. The problem then is we need to know which foods are high and which are low in FODMAPs. And we recognised this very early days and have had an ongoing program of measuring it in the content in foods, which has produced a vast amount of data on various foods. And the question was how we got this to people in a timely manner. And we've done this via the Low FODMAP Diet app, which is a very useful tool to implement the diet. It's not an educational tool. So let's come back to the gluten. One of the things we learnt when we were doing these analyses very early was that FODMAPs and gluten coexist. That if you look at all the cereals here, and I've put in beans as well, that those that are low in FODMAPs were gluten-free. And so gluten coexists with fructans, galacto-oligosaccharides, sometimes fructose. There is an exception, that's the that's a legumes. So what the idea is that if you go on a low FODMAP, if you go on a gluten-free diet, you will go on a half-reduced FODMAP diet. And in fact, when we looked at a patient, a group with non-celiac gluten sensitivity or self-reported, they had quite a lot of symptoms, but they said they were a heck of a lot better on gluten-free diet. When we put them on a full low FODMAP diet, they all improved. And then when we re-challenged them with gluten in a blinded way, then there was no specific effect of gluten. And the idea was that this was due to the reduction of fructans in the wheat and rye and barley. And there are now been four more blinded crossover studies with similar results. And there's another study which is hopefully we publish shortly from Norway, in which a crossover study was done not only with gluten in these patients with non-celiac gluten sensitivity or supposedly, but also with fructan, and the fructans were the things that had significant induction of symptoms. Now, there are other issues with a low FODMAP diet. One that we get a lot is it too complex to deliver? And I'd say no. In the early days, there was a New Zealand prospective study in which 61% of 90 patients found it easy to follow. And in the study from King's College, recently published from Heidi Staudacher, 10 minutes per patient was used for teaching the diet without teaching them mechanisms, the non-standard way. And they still, even with this, got 50% adequate relief, and more so than the placebo diet. The second issue is, can we predict a response? Who should go on this diet? And that's very difficult. Breath test pattern after sugar ingestion does not help. The bowel pattern does not help. The presence of endometriosis makes it more likely that in women that will respond to the low FODMAP diet, but this is hardly a useful clinical tool. And fecal microbiota, the pattern of fecal microbiota may predict response, but this is not useful in clinical practice at the present time. And then what about, is sucrose a FODMAP in some people? This is something which is very fascinating, and we need clinical data to know whether we should be considering sucrose isomaltase deficiency. But there's more to diet than FODMAPs and gluten. The eating style is very important. The NICE diet, which is an eating style type diet, there have been comparisons of the low FODMAP diet, two showing inferior efficacy to low FODMAP and one similar. But this gives an additive effect is the idea. There are other factors which have very few information about it, but what I'd like to stress is the key role of well-trained GI dietitians in delivering these diets. Diets do carry risks. They can precipitate eating disorders, and that you have to be careful on who it's given to. They can lead to nutritional inadequacy if not dealt with properly. They can enhance protein fermentation if fibre intake is reduced. And they can have an effect on the microbiota, although the most important study was one recently published where the microbiota was not affected longer term with a low FODMAP diet, despite it still being efficacious. What about psychological therapies? Well, there's good evidence for efficacy as they seem to improve all symptoms and quality of life. It's really difficult to obtain highest level of evidence, as Paul Moyadi had mentioned earlier, because placebos are almost impossible to design. They're currently used as a rescue therapy, and it seems to be that their efficacy is effective independently of the psychological status. So it's maybe not for the disturbed. There are multiple techniques done. And this is for your benefit, this slide, just to say that there are multiple things which have been studied, and Alex Ford's meta-analysis is shown here, showing that there are multiple different ways that have been done in one-to-one studies with generally good results. And that there's also online and self-taught ways that this can be done, also with probably less good results. I've just raised this one here, which is a meta-analysis of psychotherapy on daily functioning, and to raise the issue that simple relaxation type techniques seem to be a lot worse than things like cognitive behaviour therapy or gut-directed hypnotherapy. We wanted to know whether gut-directed hypnotherapy, which we use, is actually how it compares with the low FODMAP diet, and did a randomised study where we did one or the other or combined and found they all work similarly in about 72% of patients, 72%, something like that, and that this effect was persistent over 6 months. That's from 6 weeks therapy. The advantage was that the level of anxiety and depression reduced with the hypnotherapy, which it didn't with the others, and it persisted over 6 months. So the idea was that this is the gut-directed hypnotherapy has similar benefits to the low FODMAP diet, and maybe even more. But what was more important is that perhaps this is not a rescue therapy but a frontline therapy, and we presume it may well be the same for other psychotherapeutic approaches. What about other non-pharmacological therapies? One which I think is often forgotten is pelvic floor dyssynergia and biofeedback therapy, which is a very good therapy for constipation where there's pelvic floor dyssynergia. But unfortunately, the clues are fairly poorly specific, the clues to its present, and it requires investigation. And more importantly, it requires skilled therapists to use pelvic floor therapy. And this brings another group in, not only the dietitian or the psychologist, but also the physiotherapist. And it has a durable response. And there's just one study that I've illustrated here. The other strategies that we have to be considered, but there's not a lot of evidence. Exercise is one study which showed that a physiotherapist-led increase in physical exercise improves patient symptoms with irritable bowel syndrome. And a follow-up over 5 years, it seemed to have a prolonged benefit. Acupuncture is something which works very nicely, but unfortunately sham acupuncture works just as well as real acupuncture, and it has not had a lot of... The trouble with acupuncture is when you have a negative study, it's claimed that the acupuncture is not done properly because there are so many ways of doing it. So how do we make the choice of therapy? Do we go with the dietitian, the psychologist, etc.? Well, one of it is availability of expertise, and I would urge you all to start to develop relationships with high-quality, well-trained dietitians, psychologists, and physiotherapists. We have to have patient buy-in, and this involves also funding and insurance. Concurrent comorbidities make a difference to what you choose. If there's significant weight loss, loss of appetite, depression, anxiety, or a history of eating disorders, you certainly wouldn't want to use diet as a way. There are clues to pelvic floor dyssynergia that you would want to follow up, but there are risks to the therapies, and these have to be importantly considered. So diet with disordered eating and the risk of inducing disordered eating is a problem. Hypnotherapy, serious psychological comorbidities, particularly psychosis, is contraindicated. So my take-home messages are first that non-pharmacological strategies are rational and they're efficacious in patients with IBS. That of dietary strategies, low FODMAP diet has the highest level of evidence for most symptoms. The evidence does not support a role for gluten-free diet as a first-line therapy. And Jeff will talk about that in a moment. Of psychotherapeutic approaches, there is high level of evidence for several techniques, particularly gut-directed hypnotherapy and cognitive behaviour therapy. And benefit can be attained for all symptoms and for psychological health. Of the other approaches, biofeedback therapy is indicated where pelvic floor dyssynergia is present. But I would stress that all these approaches should be delivered by skilled health professionals and with a view to personalised therapy, which is the rule, and we need to consider the risks and benefits of all of these together. Thank you.